In 1959, a little girl was born into a poor family in one of the most remote mountainous areas of Guatemala. 1 year later, civil war broke out in Guatemala, and her tiny village was soon swept up in a tidal wave of violence. What could one family do to stand up for their rights in a time of such great change? What could one young woman do to tell the world what was happening and to try to stop the suffering? What could one movement do to share the wisdom of the ancient Maya and to determine their own future? This is a story about a family, a people, and a destiny. Rigoberta Menchú, daughter of the Maya.
Puedo empezar por decir que nací de una aldea muy pequeña, Chimel. Yo nací también de un pueblo muy pobre, un pueblo que no tenía carreteras, no tenía luz, no tenía y no tiene hasta ahora. Mi padre era un agricultor, un campesino, que no tuvo escuela, que no tuvo colegio, no habló mucho el español. Mi mamá siempre fue una mujer profundamente maya. Ella nos inculcó a nosotros un espíritu mucho más profundo al lugar donde nacimos, a los misterios de la naturaleza. Mi tierra es una tierra muy magia, que tiene misterios. Y creo en los caminos, creo en las lagunas, creo en el misterio de los barrancos. Hay muchas leyendas que contaron mis padres cuando éramos pequeños. Y tuve un abuelo que fue un gran héroe para mí, un abuelo que vivió 112 años. Y ese abuelo contaba muchas cosas. Gracias a nuestros ancestros mayas, gracias a la grandeza de sus conocimientos, gracias a la grandeza de sus saberes, de sus sabidurías, es que vivimos hoy, estamos y estamos dispuestos a renovar el futuro.
Many have heard of the greatness of the ancient Maya civilization. It reached its peak almost 2,000 years ago, at a time when the continent of Europe was struggling through the Dark Ages. Maya spiritual leaders were masters of scientific computation. They created works of great intellectual sophistication. They could time the rising of Venus to one day every 500 years, and they could calculate the periods of the phases of the moon with an accuracy that rivals that of modern astronomy. At the heart of the Maya time philosophy were 28 incredibly accurate interlocking calendars encompassing the many different dimensions of the human experience. From human biology to cycles of agriculture to the movement of stars and planets, they sought harmony by attempting to combine space with time and sought balance for the cosmos through their ceremonies.
Y nos dicen hay que tener cuidado porque el mundo tiene dueño y si el dueño del mundo castiga, es doloroso porque puede quitar las aguas, puede quitar los ríos, puede poner hambre y entonces nosotros rezamos mucho.
In 1492, when Christopher Columbus first sailed to the Americas, hundreds of thousands of Maya were thriving in the many separate and independent city-states that covered the Mayan world.
El llamado descubrimiento ha significado una larga noche de oscuridad. Independientemente de cómo hemos sobrevivido las cenizas de 500 años, ha representado para nosotros 500 años de silencio, de marginación, de mucha opresión. Y por lo tanto, nosotros no podemos festejar ni celebrar la destrucción de nuestros antepasados, ni esa noche larga de oscuridad. Opresión contra de los pueblos indígenas ha tenido nada más diferentes formas, diferentes métodos, pero una característica común ha sido la crueldad con que se ha reprimido y se ha callado la voz de nuestros pueblos.
Spanish conquistadors declared themselves the princes of the new world, and they carved up the lands that they desired into kingdoms that they meant to plunder and to conquer. Stewards of Mayan books, learning, and spiritual traditions were targeted above all. These elders began to carry on their traditions in secret constantly in danger of imprisonment and death. By the 1700s, Spain was at its peak, and the Spanish crown controlled the largest empire in the world. The Maya world was now the Kingdom of Guatemala, and the Maya were enslaved under encomienda, Spanish laws granting conquistadors trusteeship over the indigenous peoples they had conquered. The Maya world had no fortune in gold or silver. Conquistadors made their fortunes from the forced labor of the peoples themselves.
Indígenas todavía mayor viven las consecuencias de esta situación de tratos de esclavitud, solo que hoy se aplican otros métodos también.
Because it was impossible for the Maya to support themselves on a tiny plot of land they were allowed to farm, year after year, they were forced by economic necessity to work on plantations owned by Guatemala's large landholders. They were exposed to poisonous pesticides. Young children suffered from malnutrition. Rigoberta and her family, and all the families in her village, suffered on these plantations. Her little brothers, Nicolás and Felipe, died on a plantation. It was a devastating way of life, taking Maya families away from their ancestral homelands for many months every year.
Mi madre, que muchas veces no hablo de ella, pero ella fue una comadrona. Ella atendió casi todas las mujeres que dieron a luz en esa zona, no solo en Chimel, sino en todas las 18 aldeas que estaba alrededor de Chimel. Mamá caminaba, si había una señora que daba luz en la noche, venía la gente a traerlo, era prácticamente como la doctora del pueblo. Mi mamá conoció todas las plantas medicinales de Chimel, y porque es una zona que produce muchas plantas medicinales, prácticamente mi padre era un agricultor, no supo leer y escribir. No supo escribir su nombre. Todos los papeles que él firmó en ese entonces fue con su huella digital. Mi padre fue un catequista, un cristiano que supo combinar las responsabilidades de la comunidad, la lucha por la tierra.
The conquerors of Guatemala controlled the land, and hundreds of years ago, they began granting land rights, haciendas, or plantations to their descendants and to those with power and connections. Leading families in the Spanish territories gained great wealth and power. In 1821, with the decline of Spain as a world military power, all of Central America and most of Latin America declared their independence. A group of Maya leaders tried to organize and participate in the creation of the new country of Guatemala. These Maya leaders were arrested, imprisoned, and executed. A new authoritarian state was created that benefited a small group of privileged elites and which excluded from power the majority of Guatemalan people. In 1904, the situation was made even worse when the president of Guatemala signed a contract giving mass tracts of land away to one foreign company called United Fruit. United Fruit was an American corporation founded in 1899. It soon became the most important company in all of Central America. It controlled more land than anyone else. It controlled the only railroad, the port facilities, and major shipping routes, and it ran the postal, radio, and telegraph service. By the 1930s, United Fruit was the largest employer in Central America, controlling 80% of the U.S. banana trade. Governments continued to grant it huge parcels of land, and government forces shot and killed workers who tried to protest, demand higher wages, or to organize. Cheap labor made it possible to sell a dozen bananas for less than the cost of one apple produced in the USA. It was foreign deals like this that kept the elite in power and that kept the majority of Guatemalans poor, without land of their own to grow food for their families.
Cada vez que yo hablo de la historia de mis padres, siempre es necesario decir que es la vida de un colectivo, de una comunidad que para mí no ha muerto, más bien tiene que venerarse en el futuro. Desde 1950 Mi papá empezó a luchar por el pedazo de tierra para que lograran la documentación, el título de Chimel. Luchó incansablemente por gestionar esas tierras. La lucha por la tierra nos hizo mucha conciencia, nos hizo unir con otros campesinos, con otras realidades, y por lo tanto nosotros aprendimos así.
In 1951, changes took place in the capital city of Guatemala, unprecedented changes that would soon alter forever the future of the village of Chimel.
1951, springtime in Guatemala. The small Latin American country of Guatemala achieves a new milestone as peaceful democratic elections are held and a new president, Jacobo Arbenz, is elected into office. Arbenz rode a wave of popular support to win in a landslide with his promise of freedom to organize, freedom of speech, and land reform, here in a country where 2% of the people own 65% of the arable land. But the biggest landowner, the United Fruit Company, is opposing Jacobo Arbenz's proposal to buy back 40% of their properties in Guatemala, saying it smells like communism. 1954, Operation PB Success. In a move designed to prevent the creation of a Soviet beachhead only miles from the USA, the United States-owned CIA has just succeeded in toppling the government of Guatemalan President Jacobo Arbenz. The United Fruit Company was the very first to point out this looming communist threat. Here's our U.S. Vice President, Richard Nixon, who traveled all the way to Guatemala to thank the brave military leaders who helped carry out the coup. And now the U.S. has a terrific new model for dealing with small countries who refuse to toe the line.
The 1954 coup ended the 10 years of spring, and it proved to be the definitive blow to Guatemala's young democracy. Many Maya farmers burned their crops in protest as their recovered lands were once again taken away. For the next four decades, a succession of military dictators would rule Guatemala with a fist of steel.
Mi padre había sido muy perseguido. Él fue varias veces en la cárcel. Le acusaban de comunista en esos años porque luchaba por la tierra. La comunidad tuvo que hacer un gran sacrificio para sacarlo de la cárcel. Él se juntará al CUC, que es la organización campesina donde yo aprendí, donde yo crecí y donde realmente nos unimos para buscar solución a los problemas de la tierra. Nosotros vivíamos en una aldea donde se comunicaban 18 aldeas alrededor, por lo que mucha gente pedía consejos y con eso era mucho más la persecución.
Mi padre siempre me abrió una puerta. Me presentaba a varios conventos de monjas. Les platicaba que yo era una buena hija y que me dieran oportunidades. La primera vez que yo salí de mi tierra, tenía 14 años. Me aceptaron las hermanas monjas de la Sagrada Familia y trabajé allí durante 3 años. Después de esto me dieron oportunidad de estudiar y saqué los primeros 4 grados de primaria en 1 año.
The country of Guatemala headed towards civil war. Social injustice led to widespread protest and to demonstrations which were met with increased repression by the military dictators in charge. During the 1970s, the civil war began to spread to the rural regions of Guatemala.
A los años 79, que mi papá ya no podía vivir en la casa, había intensificado la violencia. Habían empezado a surgir lo que llamaron en Guatemala las patrullas de autodefensa civil. Durante ese tiempo, él recorrió muchas aldeas, muchos pueblos del Quiché, que ahora todavía la gente se acuerda de él. Nosotros salimos no juntos, sino que uno por uno.
The civil war in Guatemala continued to grow. The war would last for 36 years. Before it was over, approximately 200,000 people were killed. 83% were the indigenous people of Guatemala. The vast majority of the people killed were not guerrilla combatants, they were civilians. Almost 50,000 were simply kidnapped, disappeared.
Después, en 1979, fue que mi hermano Patrocinio fue secuestrado, estuvo 15 días desaparecido. Supimos que había gente que habían sido detenidos en la zona y entonces mi madre empezó a buscarlo y buscaba por todas partes. Mi madre visitó todos los destacamentos militares en Uspantán, en Chajul, en Nevaj. Supimos nosotros que mi hermano había sido quemado en el Chajul junto con 20 muchachos más o menos de la misma edad, y había sido muy cruelmente torturado, y sin embargo tampoco nosotros tuvimos idea de dónde quedó el cadáver.
In January of 1980, a group of indigenous farmers organized a march in the capital city of Guatemala to protest the kidnapping and murder of their people at the hands of the Guatemalan army. They were denied a hearing by Congress, and they sought refuge in the Spanish embassy building. In a police raid ordered over the objections of the Spanish ambassador, 36 people were killed, burned alive. The only survivor was taken from his hospital bed days later, tortured and killed. Spain severed its diplomatic relations with Guatemala.
Mi papá andaba uno de los líderes que entraron en la Embajada de España. Incluso él todavía le dijo a mi mamá que regresara a la casa, porque ese día andaba mi mamá con él y otros hermanos. Y él dijo, no, solo nosotros nos vamos. Y bueno, él fue uno de los quemados vivos en la Embajada de España. Había un general en el poder que ordenó la masacre de la Embajada de España.
¡Se están quemando!
Después de la muerte de mi papá, que yo recuerdo que estaba en Chiantla con las madres, las monjas de la Sagrada Familia, yo no encontraba más que hacer, más que tomar la decisión de ir a ver a mi mamá, porque ella se quedó en Chimel. Sé que los riesgos eran muy grandes, pero yo regresé y encontré a mi mamá muy fortalecida, muy fuerte. Y ella dijo, no, yo ya sé que murió tu hermano y sé que murió tu papá, pero nosotros vamos a continuar. Y yo le dije, no, tenemos que huir todos. Y bueno, él dijo que no y quedó. Ya me habían contado que mamá había sido secuestrada, le habían despojado de toda la ropa, le habían cortado el pelo, le habían torturado y que había muerto en la salida de Uspantán para Secachal, y allí habían dejado abandonado su cadáver y ella no había tenido tumba, ella había sido comido por animales. Y la mayoría de la gente que habían vivido allí había muerto. Algunos de ellos fueron fusilados, otros fueron secuestrados y después torturados. Mucha gente de la comunidad había sido masacrado. Llegó el helicóptero y bombardeó y quemó las casas. Pero de cualquier forma son pocas las gentes que viven de Chimel. O sea, donde yo nací.
Under the leadership of General Efraín Ríos Montt, the atrocities continued to grow. In 1981, he launched a brutal campaign of genocide against the indigenous people of Guatemala who were living in the mountainous highlands. His brutal scorched earth policy to pacify the countryside included a massacre in Rabinal, where 268 Mayan people were killed. Soldiers went house to house. The people were gathered into groups. The children were beaten to death. The women were raped and killed. The rest were shot, and their bodies were never found. The next day, the survivors were forced to dig mass graves, and the witnesses were forced to join the military. In Dos Erres, 160 indigenous people were massacred by the government soldiers. In Rio Negro, 440 Maya were murdered, 626 indigenous villages destroyed, completely wiped off the map.
Y es así como yo tuve que salir. No dormí en la casa. Yo llegué, salí del pueblo que era como a las 3 de la mañana, de casa en casa de gentes, como huérfana se quedó sin nada, sin hermanos, sin parientes.
Rigoberta turned to the sisters of the Holy Family, and the nuns helped her to escape from Guatemala and to find safety in exile in Mexico.
Vinieron a buscar unos religiosos en México para dejarme con ellos. Y fue el obispo Samuel Ruiz que me dijo, yo vivo cerca de tu país y todos los días miro tu país. El primero que me dijo eso, con él me quedé. Me fui a la casa de don Samuel, al arzobispado de San Cristóbal de las Casas. Me hizo una cura de sueño, que fue lo primero que me hicieron. Me dieron unas medicinas para dormir, dormir y dormir. Creo que fue el tiempo más largo que dormí en mi vida. Creo que dormí como 15 días. Y después de eso, Monseñor me dice, tú tienes que ir conmigo a las comunidades. Y por 6 meses recorrimos la selva con las comunidades indígenas, con los pueblos más lejanos de la zona de Chiapas. Así que yo tengo en mi mente, en mi corazón, mucho amor a la gente que me hizo volver a trabajar y me dio perspectiva del futuro.
By 1982, thousands of Maya had fled north over the border into Mexico to escape the devastation brought by General Ríos Montt and his army. The Guatemalan refugee community in Mexico would soon grow to more than 50,000. Rigoberta Menchú became active in the life of the refugee community, and she began to speak out, trying to tell the world what was happening to her people.
Guatemala, la lucha no es anti-ladino, sino la lucha es por una sociedad más igualitaria, más humana, más justa. Pienso que uno de los sueños más grandes que tengo en la vida es ver algún día un parlamento mixto en Guatemala. Un parlamento de indígenas y de ladinos legislando sobre la tierra, la vida, la economía, legislando sobre la existencia de los pueblos indígenas. Y donde ese parlamento hayan hombres y mujeres, indígenas y no indígenas, en iguales condiciones y en iguales proporciones. Ese tiempo yo creo que será el tiempo más alegre de la historia de nuestros pueblos. Demasiado pedirle a la vida si uno pide siquiera un parlamento mixto y un hijo y ya.
Later that year, Rigoberta was invited to talk to some delegates at the United Nations about the situation in Guatemala. She then traveled to Geneva to share details about the atrocities being committed with representatives from different European nations. She was interviewed for many hours over the course of 1 week by a writer who turned those interviews into a book that gave many their first glimpse at the hardships that her people were facing. She was asked to provide narration for a documentary film that captured the Guatemalan Civil War on the ground. And for 10 long years, she traveled to any place she could find where people wanted to help to end the suffering in Guatemala.
Hay una causa común de todo lo que significa la destrucción, pero también causa común de la esperanza. Eso quizá uno de los retos más grandes finalizando el siglo XX y eliminar la discriminación y el racismo que hemos vivido a lo largo de 500 años.
In October of 1992, Rigoberta was greeted by Nobel Peace Prize winner Adolfo Pérez Esquivel of Argentina when she returned from exile in Mexico to her home country of Guatemala. She joined her community in marking the 500-year anniversary of Christopher Columbus landing in the Americas. Millions of indigenous people around the world held similar protests that same day.
Creo que este es un día muy importante. Muchos hermanos del mundo, especialmente en el continente, están haciendo la misma manifestación.
Adolfo Pérez Esquivel nominated Rigoberta for the Nobel Peace Prize, and many indigenous activists around the world were hoping for their cause to be recognized in such an important way.
The Norwegian Nobel Committee has decided to award the Nobel Peace Prize for 1992 to Rigoberta Menchú from Guatemala, in recognition of her work for social justice and ethno-cultural reconciliation based on respect for the rights of indigenous peoples.
Hoy el mundo nos mira.
Oficial que estoy dando después de la gran alegría de oír el premio. Quisiera hacer un homenaje a todos los hermanos indios de América. Sé que me escucharán en cualquier rincón. Ellos han luchado por esto. No fue los méritos personales de Rigoberta Menchú. Fue la memoria de América.
Indigenous activists now had the attention of the world.
December 1992, the Nobel Peace Prize is awarded to a Guatemalan Indian. For more than a decade, Rigoberta Menchú has championed the cause of indigenous people of Latin America. Half a millennium exactly after the discovery of that continent, her prize is an acknowledgement of the cruelty indigenous Indians endured for centuries. The real test of whether the award has changed the situation inside Guatemala will be reflected here in the refugee camps across the border. The army arrived one night and began killing everyone in the village. They'd already destroyed the neighboring village. My brother-in-law was killed. We hid in the woods until nightfall and then crossed the mountains 4 days before we escaped Guatemala. The soldiers rounded up all the men in the village, then shot dead two a day for a week until the remaining men agreed to join them. Before killing them, they were forced to point out the Catholic leaders in the village. Once they'd done that, they were killed anyway. I lost all the men in my family and fled here with the children. The 1980s were probably the bloodiest decade in Guatemala's history. It was a period that saw a deliberate, scorched earth policy by the army. Thousands of people disappeared. Whole villages were displaced and forced into exile. People were chased across the mountains.
It was a day full of tears. It was a day full of emotion when in January of 1993, the first wave of Civil War refugees began to return to Guatemala.
Para que puedan vivir en ello y cultivar en ello la capacidad más grande.
refugee of the Civil War, Angel Canil, joined with Rigoberta in marriage, and they were blessed with the birth of a beautiful son, who they named Mash.
The world's longest civil war could be coming to an end. For 36 years, Guatemala's military has been fighting leftist guerrillas. But now a ceasefire is in place, and the two sides are meeting and talking in Mexico City.
La insurgencia se reunía con el gobierno, con el ejército y las Naciones Unidas. Discutían en privado, en secreto, el destino de la guerra y la paz. Y nosotros paramos las orejas detrás de la puerta y cuando salían nos presionábamos. Le decían, tiene que pasar esto, tiene que escribir esto. Y proponíamos el contenido de esa paz. Nosotros estábamos muy activos con los refugiados. Había más de 50,000 refugiados en México. Los refugiados éramos una fuerza muy grande para decir no más la guerra, ya no más guerra, sí a la paz. Y todo esto les presionaba a los dos actores de la guerra. Las madres decían, yo ya no quiero que mi hijo se vaya a la guerra, ni con la guerrilla ni con el ejército. Yo no quiero que el ejército reclute a mi hijo para la guerra, tampoco quiero que la guerrilla reclute a mi hijo para la guerra. Eran las madres que presionaron mucho para que terminara la guerra.
Guatemalan rebels and the Guatemalan government signed a permanent ceasefire Wednesday to end Latin America's longest civil war. Among the guests invited to the peace signing at Oslo City Hall was Rigoberta Menchú, the Maya activist who accepted the Nobel Peace Prize in the same building in 1992.
Cuando en este lugar solemne recibimos el premio Nobel, teníamos la esperanza de que algún día podríamos hablar de paz.
Amnesty for wartime atrocities has been a key issue in the talks, bringing mixed feelings about the terms of peace and raising questions about whether mass murderers and torturers can be forgiven.
Once the peace accords were signed, the drive began to find some sort of justice for the victims, mainly the indigenous Maya of Guatemala.
La gente luchó por tierra. Luchó por un pedazo de tierra, cultivarla, tener una perspectiva de sus hijos, un seguro de vida. Y ese seguro de vida llevó a la muerte. Yo pienso que fuera una ofensa personal, sería mucho más fácil perdonarla, olvidarla e iniciar una vida nueva. Pero esto no es un horror personal ni es una ofensa personal. Es una ofensa colectiva, es la memoria colectiva de Guatemala.
A truth commission has been set up in Guatemala to shed light on the thousands of political crimes that were carried out during its 36-year civil war. Guatemala's Commission for Truth has been set up to try to find answers to some very painful questions. Thousands of citizens are demanding the truth about what happened to friends and loved ones abducted by military groups during the country's long civil war. And although it is easy to guess the fate of many of the victims, the country is littered with makeshift mass graves, where bodies have been dumped at a time when no questions would be asked. Many hope to finally know where their loved ones rest. Most of the blame is placed on the military, but the Truth Commission has a difficult task ahead. The commission is aware of the Army's role, but does not want to accuse it before producing all of the facts. Others, such as Nobel Peace Laureate Rigoberta Menchú, are much clearer about their position.
Somos las víctimas quienes deberíamos de viabilizar todo lo que se refiere al reclamo de la justicia. Creo que sin justicia no tendría sentido solo saber qué pasó, porque las víctimas ya sabemos qué pasó.
The commission will have to find its way between the army and the church and the victims before it can write a new chapter in this country's bloody history.
Witnesses began to testify, despite the death threats being made against them. Rigoberta Menchú was attacked by a conservative academic and by the press, accused of lying about the deaths of members of her family. In April of 1998, tensions came to a head. The Catholic Church's Office of Human Rights, led by Bishop Girardi, released a report which stated that the vast majority of the atrocities committed during the Civil War were committed by the Guatemalan military. 2 days later, Bishop Girardi was beaten to death with a concrete slab. His face destroyed so badly that he could only be identified by his Episcopal ring. 1 year later, the United Nations Historical Clarification Commission issued a report stating that 93% of the atrocities were committed by the Guatemalan army and that the state's action constituted a policy of genocide. Rigoberta Menchú filed a complaint with the Spanish High Court, asking them to conduct the genocide trials there because of the complete lack of action of any court in Guatemala. And the exhumations of the mass graves continued. In 2002, Rigoberta Menchú flew to Rabinal, the site of one of the worst massacres. The people of Rabinal were told, at the threat of death, to keep secret the things that happened there. Instead, they have exhumed the mass graves and created a memorial for the loved ones who were lost. Witnesses describe what happened here during the war. They say that the government built this gymnasium over one of the biggest mass graves in the region to keep it secret. Prayers were said for those whose bodies remain buried under the gymnasium. Their bodies will never be recovered. Soldiers burned many of the bodies, and the remains are intermingled, so most of the victims are buried together in one site. For justice for the victims of Guatemala Civil War suffered a serious setback when the Supreme Court of Guatemala cleared the way for former dictator Efraín Ríos Montt to run for president in the year 2003. Efraín Ríos Montt won 19% of the vote that year.
The Spanish High Court has issued an arrest warrant for Efraín Ríos Montt and seven other Guatemalan military officials. The former Guatemalan dictator said Wednesday that the order for his arrest was unfounded and insisted that he was not aware of any atrocities by military officials during the country's 36-year civil war. The Spanish High Court issued warrants on charges of genocide, torture, terrorism, and illegal detention. Human rights groups say Ríos Montt is responsible for some of the worst atrocities of the war, which left 200,000 people dead before peace accords were signed in December 1996. The arrest warrants stem from charges of genocide, torture, and murder filed in Spanish courts in 1999 by Guatemalan Nobel Peace Prize winner Rigoberta Menchú. According to a UN Truth Commission, the army was responsible for 626 separate massacres of civilians, mostly Maya Indians, during the war. About half of those occurred in 1982 and 1983, when Ríos Montt was running the country.
A fusilar a quien esté en contra de la ley.
Ríos Montt acted quickly to avoid prosecution. He ran as a candidate for Congress, and he won. As a member of Guatemala's Congress, he now had immunity for any sort of action against him for any war crime. In 2006, some of the most talented Maya leaders answered back by creating a new movement which they called WINAC. And they asked Rigoberta to open the door by stepping up and becoming the very first Maya woman to ever run for president in the history of Guatemala.
Yo creo que es muy importante el paso, dar un paso para medir qué tanto son útiles o qué tanto es posible los cambios en Guatemala.
The campaign took WINAC across the country.
WINAC está en construcción. ¿Cómo podemos nosotros dar un seguimiento para crear un nuevo prototipo de liderazgo? Quizá nuestro sueño no se puede hacer en 20 años, tal vez en 100 años. Nosotros lo que estamos haciendo ahora es abrir una brecha, es empezar un camino. Para nosotros los mayas es gloria, es triunfo, es éxito iniciar un camino. Nosotros estamos haciendo historia, estamos escribiendo historia. El camino va a la construcción de una nueva sociedad donde la regla sea la pluralidad. WINAC es un sueño realizado.
Rigoberta sets out to record the very first television commercial for a Maya woman running for president.
Tres, dos, dale.
Pero nos urgen gobernantes que nos dirijan
con ejemplo y congruencia.
Es que sí. Bueno.
Tres, dos, acción.
Que sin egoísmos personales tomen lo mejor de la gente para el bien de todos.
One more.
Two more.
Muy sonriente, muy importante,
Para Guatemala, un nuevo amanecer en donde podamos vivir en paz.
Then, terrible news. Two of the UNAC candidates have been assassinated. Many Maya are reluctant to get involved. In the past, to get involved meant kidnapping, torture, and death. The assassinations continue. In total, 14 UNAC members are killed. On election day, Rigoberta Menchú comes in seventh place.
Primero somos movimiento y luego somos partido. Y si somos partido fuerte, debemos de ser un movimiento fuerte.
The work to create the first ever Indigenous People's Party in Guatemala begins. First, two representatives must be elected from every single precinct. Then, tens of thousands of signatures from those who choose to join this new party must be collected.
Hay gente que no quiere estar en WINAC, aunque sea maya, pues lo vamos a respetar profundamente.
In May of 2011, WINAC representatives from across the country gathered. They adopt bylaws and elect officers. The final challenge, to become an official political party, WINAC must win at least two seats in Congress this fall election. The leadership of WINAC votes and asks Rigoberta to head the ticket once again. Her main opponent, Otto Pérez Molina, served in the Guatemala military's notorious special forces. And he was rumored to be involved in the massacres, tortures, and assassinations of the era. In this presidential campaign, he promises to rule Guatemala with an iron fist, to crush violent drug cartels, and to restore law and order in Guatemala. As election day approaches, many WINAC candidates are thrown off the ballot. And on the day of the election, 65 different incidents of election fraud are reported, the majority which happen in indigenous regions of the country. WINAC comes in sixth, and Rigoberta wins 44% more votes than she did in 2007. And success WNAC wins 2 congressional seats and 1 mayor's office, and is now the first official indigenous party in the history of Guatemala. 2 months after the election, Otto Pérez Molina started his first term as president, and Efraín Ríos Montt's term came to an end, and so did his immunity from prosecution of war crimes. He was placed under house arrest.
Former dictator Efraín Ríos Montt has appeared in court today in a genocide case involving crimes against indigenous Guatemalans during his military dictatorship in the 1980s. Ríos Montt appeared, but refused to testify in court in Guatemala City. The building was surrounded by thousands of people demanding justice. Ríos Montt has been accused of mounting some of the worst massacres in the Guatemalan Civil War. He had legislative immunity until 2 months ago. The 86-year-old former general has said that he operated in a war and is willing to face justice.
The genocide trial of a Guatemalan dictator, Efraín Ríos Montt, came to a close today. The Attorney General's office has presented forensic reports from anthropologists and plans for military operations, along with testimony of rapes, torture, assassinations, and forced displacements. During the 1960 to 1996 Civil War, more than 200,000 people, mostly Maya Indians, were killed or went missing, and entire villages were exterminated, according to the United Nations. Ríos Montt is the first former head of state to be tried for genocide in his home country. A judge read out, quote, "By unanimous decision, the court has declared that the accused, Efraín Ríos Montt, is responsible as the author of the crime of genocide. He is responsible as the author of the crimes against humanity committed against the life and integrity of the civilian residents of the villages and hamlets located in the mountainous regions of Guatemala."
Sí, está acreditada la verdad. Lo dijo un tribunal convencional que usa normas convencionales a nivel internacional. No importa que el señor Ríos Montt termine sus 80 años de prisión en una cama de seda. Lo más importante es el precedente de esa resolución, que nos dijeron mentirosos todo el tiempo, que nos dijeron que inventábamos los hechos, y hoy hay un tribunal que dice que sí hubo genocidio. Esa voz nadie lo va a apagar, ni en Guatemala ni en el mundo. No creíamos que llegó el día que tanto esperamos por 33 años y luego lloramos. Pero no llorábamos de cobardía ni de tristeza. Llorábamos quizá de alegría.
10 days later, the Supreme Court in Guatemala overturned the conviction and called for a new trial based on a legal technicality. The lawyers for Efraín Ríos Montt began to use every tactic possible to delay the start of that new trial. But the drive for justice for the victims of Guatemala's civil war continued on. The Guatemalan Human Rights Prosecution Unit finally brought charges against the man who orchestrated the burning of the Spanish embassy.
The trial of a former police chief charged with the death of 37 people in a fire at the Spanish embassy in Guatemala City in 1980 began on Wednesday. Nobel laureate Rigoberto Menchú, whose father, Vicente, died in the fire nearly 35 years ago, is a plaintiff in the case. Pedro García Arredondo, former chief of a special police unit known as Command 6, is charged with murder and crimes against humanity for ordering the burning of the embassy and 37 victims who were burned alive. The fire at the embassy on 31st January 1980 came when farmers, workers, students, and members of the religious and indigenous communities occupied the embassy building seeking to denounce the massacres that were taking place. The incident has been called the defining moment of the Guatemalan Civil War. Throughout the occupation, police blocked the doors and didn't allow anyone out or anyone to come to the rescue when the fire began.
Estoy aquí porque quiero cerrar un capítulo de 34 años de mi vida, que quiero la verdad justicia y quiero entonces que las generaciones venideras respeten absolutamente, absolutamente la vida.
A court in Guatemala sentenced the former head of a special police unit to 90 years in prison on Monday for the deaths of 37 people in a fire at the Spanish embassy in 1980.
Pedro García Redondo es autor responsable de los delitos de asesinato cometido en contra de la vida y la integridad de las personas siguientes.
La verdad se nos ha negado en estos 35 años. Y hoy queda claro la responsabilidad del señor Pedro García Redondo, pero también todas las personas que ustedes oyeron que fue citado en la audiencia, muchos de ellos ya fallecieron, pero también la responsabilidad del Estado. Y creo que eso es lo que más nos alegra, y nos alegra un debido proceso, porque tuvimos la paciencia de llegar hasta este momento. Y de veras que estamos muy emocionados.
Guatemala suffered 36 years of armed conflict ending in 1996, which left at least 200,000 people dead or missing.
3 months later, international prosecutors, with the help of the United Nations, presented evidence of a customs corruption ring at the highest levels of the Guatemalan government.
Thousands of Guatemalans took to the streets of the capital on Saturday to voice anger over the corruption that permeates their government. Despite heavy rainfall, the protesters gathered in Guatemala City's Constitution Square to call on President Otto Perez Molina to resign and to demand jail time for the guilty. The march, organized through social media, drew support from a wide range of sectors in Guatemala, including business, academics, churches, human rights advocates, and indigenous leaders. The latest scandal involves what prosecutors allege was a multi-million dollar scheme in which bribes were paid by Guatemalan companies to avoid customs duties on imports. Vice President Roxana Baldetti was forced to resign a week ago amid allegations of her role in the customs fraud and bribery scheme. But President Otto Perez Molina rejects any calls for his own resignation.
Jamás en la historia del planeta he visto un presidente que está siendo juzgado en un tribunal y sigue siendo honorable.
The protests continued on, week after week and month after month.
Para empezar, déjeme preguntarle esto. ¿Cómo definiría usted la situación que vive Guatemala?
Usted ve los temas de justicia, que realmente es un brete, es un desafío para el sistema legal que tenga que juzgar la ex vicepresidenta y el próximo expresidente, con todo un tema que no se había tocado en Guatemala, que es el crimen organizado, que son los delitos ilícitos desde el alto nivel, y que esto afecta a la dignidad de los guatemaltecos.
El presidente Otto Pérez Molina dice que él se va a quedar en el poder y que no va a renunciar.
Yo creo que Otto Pérez ya cayó desde el momento en que se encontró su vínculo con la línea, que es eso, la organización criminal que ha llevado el día de hoy a la señora Baldetti a la prisión preventiva. Ya nosotros presentamos nuestro partido, el Movimiento Político Huina, el compañero Amílcar Pop, presentó y solicitó el antejuicio contra el presidente.
Rigoberta, si le entiendo bien, entonces, para usted, para Rigoberta Menchú, ¿ya no reconoce a Otto Pérez Molina como presidente de Guatemala?
No, ya no, traicionó el voto popular. Traicionó la confianza de los guatemaltecos. Hay delitos graves.
Outside the National Palace, hundreds of people celebrated the resignation and the arrest of former Guatemalan president Otto Perez Molina, who just spent his first night in jail. 2 days ago, Congress stripped him of all immunity against prosecution. The vote was 132 to nothing.
Never before in the history of Guatemala has a president resigned over criminal charges.
Es un acontecimiento extraordinariamente único en la historia de Guatemala. Durante más de 50 años, aquí se ha tenido un miedo extraordinario a los militares. Esos militares que no están dispuestos a quitar la bota, se mueren con su bota puesta. Y por eso para nosotros es una gran alegría la renuncia de Otto Pérez Molina. No solo es que cayó un general represivo, sino también cayó un general que tenía implicación en un pasado sangriento en Guatemala.
Es un hombre de guerra y es un hombre de inteligencia. Entonces, si él es un hombre de inteligencia, es un hombre peligroso.
On February 1st, 2016, the courts of Guatemala launched a landmark trial against former military officers accused of committing crimes against humanity. The victims lived in a small Maya village, and they were targeted for defending their land. The 15 families involved were fighting for legal titles for the lands that they had lived on for years. Guatemalan soldiers came to their village, murdered the 15 men, and then came back for their wives. The 15 women were raped and taken captive and enslaved at the Sepur Sarco military base. This despicable treatment lasted for many months. During the Guatemalan Civil War, rape was widespread and systemic, but this is the only case that has ever gone to trial. The women endured intense physical and emotional trauma. Some were used as sex slaves for years during 20 days of courageous testimony. They told their story in harrowing detail to prove that crimes against humanity, including sexual violence, sexual slavery, and forced disappearance, did indeed occur. Finally, the verdict was delivered. It was a historic sentence of 360 years and a new judicial precedent for the prosecution of cases of sexual violence in situations in armed conflict wherever they occur.
Impresionante el colonialismo en Guatemala. Es muy importante decir que los pueblos indígenas, nosotros somos parte de un sistema paralelo al Estado guatemalteco, donde practicamos nuestros idiomas, practicamos los conocimientos ancestrales de nuestros abuelos. Tenemos un instrumento valiosísimo que es el Sagrado Calendario Maya, que nos ayuda a comprender el tiempo. Nos enseña un sistema integral de vida. Bueno, si estamos de acuerdo que hay dos sistemas en Guatemala, el sistema ancestral y el sistema occidental, entonces podemos encontrar muchas formas de armonización. Podemos encontrar muchas formas de coexistencia, de vida conjunta, y podemos crear lazos de amistad para una construcción de un país plural. Buinak será un instrumento para dignificar a nuestros pueblos, pero también a dignificar nuestros difuntos. Y debe ser un canal para poder romper los esquemas del colonialismo y romper los esquemas de la imposición, romper esos peligros del fascismo, pero también romper los muros del racismo y de la discriminación.
Quizá nuestro sueño no se puede hacer en 20 años, en 30 años. Tal vez nuestro sueño se puede hacer en 52 años, en los cuatro Tanaj, como dice nuestro sagrado calendario maya. ¿Va a venir una nueva era para nuestros pueblos? Yo creo que sí. ¿Va a haber un nuevo tiempo donde florezca los saberes mayas? Yo digo que sí. Yo creo que si mi padre estuviera vivo, si él fuera un dirigente en este momento, yo estoy segura que mi papá sería muy orgulloso de ver un instrumento político que finalmente invita a la gente a ejercer sus derechos.